What's up, everybody? It's Reverend Leon Parker, lead pastor of St. Luke CME Church. As a community-based church, we are dedicated to exploring opportunities that will enhance the standard of living and save souls for the kingdom of God. Here at St. Luke, we are committed to impacting lives by building an essential church through relevant ministries that touches lives, meets needs, and glorifies God.
Because you first love me, I really love you. Yes, I do.
We invite you to join our worship experience every Sunday at 10 a.m. as we embrace God's word and God's people. To learn more about our community, we encourage you to visit our website at www.stluke.cme.org. God bless you, we love you, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Lift every voice.
Lift every voice and sing.
Till earth and heaven.
Till earth and heaven ring.
Ring with the harmonies.
Ring with the harmonies.
Of liberty.
Of liberty.
Let our rejoicing.
Let our rejoicing rise.
High as the
listening skies.
Let it
resound.
Loud as the rolling.
Loud as the rolling.
Sing
a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us.
Sing a song.
Sing a song
full of the hope,
full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun. Let us march on
to victory.
Is one
third verse. God of our weary years.
God of our weary years.
God of our silent tears.
God of our silent tears.
Now who has,
brought us thus far on the way?
Thou
who has by thy might
led us
into the light.
Keep us forever.
Keep us forever. Where we met thee,
lest
our hearts drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Thank you for your gift and contribution to St. Luke's CME Church and partnering with us to build an essential church through relevant ministries that touch lives, meet needs, and glorifies God. Your gifts enable us to focus on education, community development, legacy giving, and creating God's kingdom for all people and all generations. There are 5 ways to give to St. Luke. Please go to stlukecme.org and click the Giving tab. Or text the word GIVE to 615-334-5900. You can also bring your contributions to the church office during normal business hours or mail your contribution to St. Luke CME Church, 2008 Ed Temple Boulevard, Nashville, Tennessee, 37208. We invite you to download the Easy Tithe app available for all smart devices in your application store. Thank you for giving to St. Luke CME Church as we embrace God's word and God's people. And we declare a blessing over your gift. Truly, if you give, it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over.
Gather all my good, and I know that all things work together.
I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything. anything. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything. Come on, all over the building, wherever you are, one voice.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you. I want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you more than anything.
Come on, one more time. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you. I want to tell you.
Just want to tell you.
Lord, I love
you. Lord, I love you more than anything.
Come on, one more time. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship and adore you. I want to tell you.
Just want to tell you. Lord, I love you more than anything.
I love you. I love you, Lord, today. Because you cared for me in such a special way. That's why I praise you. I lift you up and I magnify your name. That's why my heart is filled with praise. That's why my heart is filled with praise. That's why my heart is filled with praise.
Come on, let's celebrate the Lord. Amen. We're so glad to be here yet again in the house of God today. Amen. If you have your Bibles, we ask that you would journey with us to the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter. Amen and amen. We thank God for this awesome praise team and music ministry that ministered before this sacred moment on this morning. And we're so grateful for you, those of you who are tuning in with us live as we continue to practice social distancing, as we continue to keep you safe and to keep you in mind during these uncertain times. Song of my heart goes something like this. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Come on back, Jonathan. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. Take us to the chorus. Oh, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, this is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, perfect submission. God bless you, Crystal. Perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst in my sight. Angels defend. bring from above. Echoes, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. Third verse, perfect submission. Perfect submission. All is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Oh, we're watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. Will you help me sing it? Oh, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. One more time. All the day long. Come on, put those hands together. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. Praising my Savior all the day long. Oh, this is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. The Gospel of John, chapter 20. Praising my Savior. Starting at the 24th verse. The Gospel of John, chapter 20, starting at the 24th verse. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, who was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands, the mark of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, the word of God says, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put your hand and place it in my side. Don't disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you've seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Let us pray. God, we love you. And sometimes in this season, our love for you is challenged. But nonetheless, we trust in you. We ask, Lord God, that you would bless this preach moment on this third Sunday of July, that lives may be transformed and enhanced for the upbuilding of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen and amen. So glad again that you're with us this morning, streaming live, watching from YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, however you've tuned in. We're so grateful for you to be with us today. I want to talk about something that we all experience in life. Have you ever been in a season of doubt? A season of doubt. Well, for this sermonic moment, I want to tag the message this morning. I need some proof. I need some proof. In the midst of all that we are going through, I need some proof that God is still on the throne. I need some proof that God is still working. And so as I go into this message, I want to talk about how we live really in a microwave, here today, gone tomorrow society. We live in an Instagram, Facebook, Twitter generation, where as what we see is really not what it is to be. You see, people don't see what we really look like before we angle the camera to take that right selfie, right? People don't know what we go through when we put on the filters on these apps and things to really get the shot and the kind of angle that we're looking for. And that's the kind of society we live in. We live in a society where there is some credible news, but in most cases, most of our news outlets don't tell the truth, which skews our view on certain things. We live in a society where we have to see something in order to believe it, right? And so as believers, we must be careful that we do not fall into the trap of such thinking when the Bible tells us that a double-minded man is unstable in how many different ways? All their ways. So you see, when it comes to a double-mindedness is what I'm really talking about, we cannot call ourselves a follower of Jesus Christ and then reject the community that we are called to serve. When it comes to double-mindedness, we cannot have the Burger King motto, wanting to have it our way and not heeding to the word of God, that God is Emmanuel, that God is with us in protest, in pandemic, that God is with us in all things. We cannot follow Christ and at the same time reject his people because of the color of their skin, because of their political views. We can't do that. We can't ask God to bless us, and we can't give back the minimum of what God has blessed us with. We cannot be double-minded in the kingdom of God. And so the text for our consideration today shows us a common struggle that many of us, if I were to be real, myself and others, deal with and experience in our very lives. On one hand, we acknowledge that God is Hosanna, and we shout unto him like those who shouted that Palm Sunday. And on the other hand, we find ourselves sometimes turning our heads in doubt as though we do not know him. And oftentimes we find ourselves in a season of doubt when we are really in a season of drought, when we're in a season when things don't work our way, when we're in a season when it seems like death is lurking at our back door, when we're in a season where our money is funny. Oftentimes when we are in our loader bar, when we are in our desert situations, is when we find ourselves oftentimes in doubt. Do I have any witnesses here? Yeah. We find ourselves in this space of doubt. I want you to know that we can't follow Christ and at the same time reject his people. We can't follow Christ and at the same time doubt his promises. The word of God is very, very clear to us again that a double-minded man is unstable. A double-minded woman is unstable in his or her ways. At some point in our lives, we have to experience the joy of resurrection and the pains of doubt. I'm going somewhere with this. Philosopher René Descartes says in one of his most notable quotes that if you would be real, or if you want to be a real seeker after truth, it is necessary that at least one time in your life you doubt as far as possible all things. In other words, what he is trying to help us to understand is that in order to understand knowledge, in order for understanding and certainty of truthfulness to come about, every now and again, we must engage in doubting to understand that it has its place. We must indulge in doubting to find ourselves in a teachable moment that we see with Thomas and Jesus in the text this morning. See, in order to establish certainty or what is true, the philosopher Descartes suggests that there are certain times in our lives, in our reality, that we must test our beliefs by doubting. Come on, somebody. In other words, doubt, the opposite of certainty, recognizes the fact that if we indulge in this feeling or this mindset of doubt, we're not necessarily believing that something is not true, but we are exercising the thought to find truth in our questioning. Am I making sense this morning? Because certainty is the opposite of doubt. Finding out what we can and cannot doubt establishes what we can be certain of. In other words, there will always be people in your life who doubt you. There will always be people in your life who tell you that you can't do it. There will always be people in life that will find the negative in things instead of pushing you and encouraging you to go ahead and to jump off the cliff, understanding that God will catch you. Life is full of people, come on somebody, whose mission is to see you fail. They majored in doubting when they were in high school. They majored in doubting when they were in college. And now they work for the most powerful company, doubt. They want to see you fail. They want to talk about you. They want to humiliate you. Oftentimes we doubt ourselves, come on somebody. When we don't reach the goals we intend for our lives, when we don't reach the ideal weight. Let me tell you something. I was supposed to be a millionaire at the age of 25. And now that I look around and as I check my bank account this morning, I'm nowhere near that. Oftentimes we find ourselves doubting our goals, doubting our ideal weight when we didn't accomplish a major goal within that certain timeline we set forth. We find ourselves in a season of doubt. And if I can be real this morning, there are times when we even find ourselves doubting God. There are times when we are guilty of not believing and holding true to the promises of God. There are times when we feel God has completely abandoned us, and in the midst of our self-proclaimed abandonment, we see and find doubt setting up residency in our minds, setting up residency in our spirits, even as children of God. We find ourselves doubting like the Israelites. However, I want you to know that when we reach a season of doubt, we must use it in such a way that God reveals to us that no matter how the story of our lives are played out, at the end of the day, we will find that He is certain to deliver on His promises. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but every now and again, when doubt creeps up, there's a time when we want to prove or have proof of certainty and evidence of assurance, that it is in those times we don't need to go looking for the proof because God has already given it to us. Come on, somebody. And as we look at our text today, we find that even the people who were Christ's chosen disciples were found guilty by the high courts of doubting Christ and His power. As we look upon the pages of the Word of God, we find that there was a brother by the name of Thomas. He doubted so much they called him Doubting Thomas. That was his nickname. He doubts the reports of the disciples that indeed Christ has returned, thusly earning his name, Doubting Thomas. Thomas had seen time and time again. Thomas was there. Thomas was the Eat You Hollywood. Thomas was there before TMZ, seeing all these things that Jesus had done, hearing all these promises, seeing Him do the unthinkable and the unimaginable, yet it is he who doubts. Now, I want to be clear. I want you to understand that doubting is something that we find throughout the Bible, but we rarely look at it as something liberating. Yeah, doubting can be liberating. As a matter of fact, we learn as the women returned from the tomb sharing that Jesus' body was not there and that He had risen, that the disciples themselves were doubting the certainty of what was reported to them. Come on. And it was after the women's discovery and their confirmation, after the proclamation, Christ himself showed up on the scene. You say, well, what does this have to do with anything? Easter is coming, gone. Well, somebody still may be asking the question, if all these people gave witness that Christ was alive, why didn't Thomas believe? After his crucifixion and resurrection, Jesus appeared alive and glorified to his disciples to comfort them and to proclaim to them the good news of his victory over death. But Thomas was not there. Come on, somebody. Even after being told by his brothers, Jesus appeared walking with them within the same week. But Thomas, he wanted physical proof of the risen Lord in order to believe. Thomas said in his sanctified mind that if y'all want me to believe what you say, then I need proof. And I know some of us who are in this setting right now, some of us who are viewing, we've said it in our minds time and time again. I hear what you're saying. I understand what you're saying, but I need what? Some proof. I need some evidence. And so Thomas is in this spirit of needing to have the solid evidence to believe what everyone else is believing. And so let me ask this question. Has anyone ever been there before? You wanted to believe that text message that was sent. You wanted to believe those test results, but there was something in you that said, I need more proof than what I have. And so 1 week after his resurrection, 7 days, we find the disciples in the upper room with the door locked. Now, it's important to note that the door was locked because as they all are locked in the room, Thomas, he comes in, and after hearing the news and missing the appearances of Christ, he becomes doubtful. But even while they're in that room and the door is locked, someone shows up after Thomas says, again, I need some proof. And so it's here in the room that Thomas gets the proof that he needs. Let me tell you something, that God will give you proof in God's time, and you just got to shut up and be still. It's okay to question. It's okay to contemplate. But when you finish questioning and contemplating, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength, shall renew their faith, shall receive the proof that they need. And so here it is. Thomas gets his proof, and I don't know again who this is for, but how many of you know that there is power in being in certain rooms? Watch this. Thomas was being in the room that created a space to shape and to transform the rest of his life. In this room, Thomas was renewed by the way he thought. He was renewed by the evidence that was presented to him. Thomas had a new way of believing Christ and believing the word of God after he had his experience in this room. Here it is, we find Thomas walking through an open door into the open room, but we find Jesus coming right behind him into a closed door. And that's how our Christ is. He always has a way of reminding us that his promises are true, that the word that is recorded and appeared in such a way will not come void, because God is God. God is sovereign. God is a God who holds true to his promises. But this wasn't enough for Thomas. So you ought to say, I need some more proof. What changed Thomas's doubt was in verse 26. It says, although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and spoke, saying, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands. Put out your hand and place it into my side. Thomas was not in that room, I don't think he would have gotten the proof that was needed to change his position. And this is a lesson for us this morning. We are not perfect in our faith. Come on, somebody. We are not perfect as people. And I thank God, because this text gives us the permission to confess that, yes, I'm a Christian, but I ain't perfect. Yes, I believe in God, but sometimes I doubt. Yes, I believe. Yes, I serve. Yes, I give. But sometimes the human in me begs for a little more proof. Yes, I love the Lord, but but there's still some work in my life to be done. Yeah, I go to church, I read my word, but the Lord sometimes doesn't get to and through me as I would have thought he would. You see, doubting helps to liberate us. I don't know who you are, but I want to encourage you to stop burdening yourself trying to look like the perfect Christian, because there's no perfect Christian. Every now and then, the best of us who are faced with doubting, and that's the perfect opportunity for God to step in. When we're faced with doubting, that's the teaching moment for God to step in and to show himself mighty and to show God's self strong. We're like Thomas in verse 27, with proof time and time again, with God's word, he's guaranteed to show up, even in the midst of our doubt. And so as I close, I want you to understand, as Jesus says to Thomas, to put your finger here and to look at my hands, he says, put your hand in the wound so that you can believe it's really me. Some of us think that in order to believe Christ, we need a definite or tangible sign or miracle. But Jesus reminds us that we are blessed if we can believe without seeing. None of us have seen the face of Jesus, but we believe that he is the Son of God. None of us was there when he died on the cross, but we believe in John 3:16 that God loved us so much that he gave his son. There was no question about it. There was no bothering. There was no thinking twice. He simply gave his son to all of us. And Jesus reminds us again that if you can believe without seeing, you are truly blessed. And it's interesting how God will change our thoughts and perspectives from needing proof to he's already proven himself. I'm going to say that again. I said it's interesting how God will change our thoughts, because God, he has a way of getting into everything. It's interesting how he works through our minds and our perspectives from needing proof like Thomas to understanding that he's already proven himself. I heard Big Mama say, if God doesn't do nothing else, he's done enough. If God don't wake me up tomorrow morning, he's done enough. He's put food on my table. He's put running in my feet. He's given me a new walk. He's kept me safe from dangers seen and unseen. There was a time when Gideon doubted God's ability to help him win against the Midianites. So what did he do? He prayed to God that God would give him the proof. And God gave him proof and a victory against the enemy. Can I call the roll? There was a time when Sarah, Abraham's wife, lied, doubted to what God said about her being pregnant in her old age. Then a year later, she was walking around pregnant. She was walking around pregnant. 9 months, she had a son. Herod and Pilate was one of those who doubted that Jesus was the Son of God. And we know how that turned out. So I want you to know, to doubt, it's biblical. And I want you to know that there will be moments and even seasons when our belief that God will turn our situations around, that will be tested. But I want you to know that when you doubt, God has a way of turning your doubt around into what he has already done. I'm proof that God will. If you're doubtful today, I want you to know that if you're listening, if you're tuning in, that you are proof that God will keep you, that God will save you, that God will take your doubt and give you the proof that you're looking for. I want you to know, to doubt is not a confession of unbelief. It's simply the frailty of man and evidence of our inability to believe things that can't be seen. You don't just see with your eyes, come on somebody, but with your mind and with your heart. Let me say that again. A smart person doesn't just see with their eyes, but with their mind and their heart through the vehicle of hope. Or as the writer says, faith. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for. To imagine the manifestation of something in your future is to see it and believe it. You ought to say vision to see, faith to believe, and the courage to do. I want you to know that it's okay, but never give in to doubt, because when God moves, he'll give you the proof. If you believe, if you press, if you heed to his answer when he calls, as long as you keep seeing him, he'll do it. He'll give you the proof. And so I close with this. In our summer jams, Alicia Keys said in one of her songs, "Show me love." In other words, she needed some proof. She said, "Show me proof." Well, Alicia Keys is married, y'all, to a man by the name of Swiss Beatz. And I'm sure she shows Swiss Beatz all the love that she can. But I want you to know this morning, I know a man who can show us proof, who can show us love. And just like he told Thomas, he said, "Put your hands here and see if I didn't die. Put your hands here and see if I wasn't pierced." But the songwriter says, he was bruised. He was bruised. He was beat. The chastisement of his people was upon him. But by his stripes, we are healed. I wish I had about three people who could say, "Be careful what you ask for." Come on, celebrate God. Celebrate God. I want you to know, the enemy's job is to tell you and to show you that things cannot be done, things are not true. But I want you to hear me when I say this, that even though you can't see God, God is in the midst of everything, and God can do what God wants to do. I want you to understand, in the midst of all of this, God is showing proof by waking you up every morning. He's showing you proof by putting food on your table every day. He's showing you proof that he is still able and he still sits on the throne. I don't know who you are, but you've been running, you've been running, you've been running for a long time. You've been asking for proof. You've been running for God, saying, "Well, I don't believe in God. I'm spiritual until he shows me truth, or until he shows me proof." Psalm says, "There are some things I may not know. There are some places I cannot go. But as for me, I am sure of this, that God is real. He's real in my soul." So if you are wanting to accept the realness of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I ask that you would text us right now on the screen. Romans 10:9 says, "If you believe, accept, and confess, you shall be saved. According to the profession of your faith, you shall be saved." And as a result, you have access to things that people who don't know Jesus Christ can experience. You have access to him at any time. He's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Second opportunity I wish to offer is, if you're looking for a church home You're looking for a covering. You need a covering in these times. You need spiritual, like-minded men and women who you can study with and pray with and share with and fellowship with in these uncertain times. And so I invite you to text JOIN. And then if you're just in need of prayer, your faith has been wavering, your faith has been trying you in these days, we want to pray for you. So again, if you want to join, you want to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, or if you're looking for a church home, text us to the number on the screen. I want you to know God is real. Look around, look at the trees, look at the birds. Pause for station identification. Touch yourself. After all that you've been through, after all that you've seen, the Lord has been gracious to you and he has kept you. So if you're asking for proof, just like Michael Jackson said, look at the man in the mirror. Come on, Cedric, help me sing that. There are some things. There are some things I may not know. There are some places.
There are some places.
We want you to know today that we love you.
Cannot go.
There's nothing you can do about it. We love you because.
But I am sure.
God loved us and God loves you.
Of this one thing.
I want you to know that God is real.
That God is real. For I can feel.
Come on, let's celebrate.
Him deep
we can
within.
Feel him. Oh, yes, God is real.
Yes, God is real.
Real in my soul.
Real in my soul.
Yes, God is real.
For he has washed.
He has washed and made.
And made me whole.
Guess what? His love for me.
Ooh, his love
is like
for
pure
me.
Gold.
Just
hear me when I say, yes, God is real.
Yes, God is real.
God bless you.
For I can feel
God bless you.
Him in my soul.
As he keeps singing, I want you to know that the Spirit of God, yes, God is amongst you. And as you go and travel and as you handle your business this week, I want you to know that God is real.
Real
when you're in a season of doubt, just look around. When you're in a season of doubt, just turn to the text and look at the proof that he gave Thomas. I want you to know that it is my prayer for God to bless you and to keep you, and that God's loving face to shine down upon you and give you peace. Go now in peace, understanding that God is real. We love you. Good morning.
Soul real, for he has washed and made me whole. His love for me, just like pure gold, real.